Hello and welcome to a special webinar of Illis Technomedia. Myself, Shovik Goswami, Senior Assistant Editor with Illis Technomedia. As you all know, Illis Technomedia is a 17-year-old company which is in the forefront on creating awareness and highlighting the importance of technology innovation for a knowledge society in 4 to 5 domains in 30-plus sectors for the last 17 years. We publish 4 niche magazines, eGov, e-health, digital learning, and the banking and finance post. We have been organizing conferences on health, education, banking and financial sector, e-governance, urban for last 17 years in various parts of India and world over. During the lockdown, in unprecedented crisis, we believe that connecting communities and connecting people should not be stopped. And in line with that, we are continuing with connecting people and connecting communities during the lockdown through our special series of webinars. Today, we have a special session with special guests from the BFSI sector, perhaps from the NBFC sector. The topic of today's webinar is role of NBFCs in the post-pandemic period. We all know, we all are feeling the crunch of economic problem for the lockdown, but what about the NBFCs? What about those sector? For that, we have a special panel, esteemed panels we have. They're the leaders from NBFC sector. They're the leaders from regulatory bodies and the BFSI sector. To start with, let me introduce with Mr. Raman Agarwal, co-chairman, Finance Industry Development Council. We welcome Mr. Agarwal.
Thank you.
We have Mr. T.T. Srinivas Raghavan, Managing Director, Sundaram Finance Limited. We have Mr. George Alexander Muthut, Managing Director, Muthut Group. We have Mr. Prabhakar Bobdev with us, CEO, Sustainable Agro Commercial Finance Limited, and Mr. Sachin Pillai, Chief Executive Officer, Hinduja Leyland Finance. I welcome all of you to a special webinar on role of NBFCs in the post-pandemic period. We'll move on to questions and the discussion and everything, but before we move on to that part, let me inform all of our panelists and attendees that we are broadcasting this webinar live through Facebook Live, through ELITS handles, BFSI handles, eGov handles, and also we'll be promoting this video, this webinar video in YouTube also. So for viewers who have joined the webinar now and who wants to see in Facebook, they can log into ELITS pages and the banking and finance post pages in Facebook, and they can see the entire happening live of the webinar. We are also tweeting through hashtag ELITS webinar through our BFSI page and BFSI handle and other ELITS handle. To begin with, let me come to Mr. Raman Agarwal. Mr. Agarwal, if you can kindly introduce yourself in 2 to 3 sentences.
So I'm Raman Agarwal, co-chairman of Finance Industry Development Council, FIDC, which is the representative body of all loan and asset financing NBFCs in India. I have worked in the NBFC sector for last 29 years now, and worked with various companies. Currently, I'm more into freelancing, advisory, consulting World Bank, consultant to Sitam Transport and few other entities. So that's my it's a pleasure to be here, especially amongst panelists, including the father figure veteran in the sector, Mr. TTS, and of course, Mr. Muthu, Mr. Bobde, and Mr. Sachin. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you so much for joining us. And as Mr. Raman said, Mr. TTS, T.T. Srinivas Raghavan, Managing Director, Sundaram Finance Limited. If you can just talk about yourself for a brief intro.
Yeah, thank you, Shovik. It's a pleasure to be on this panel with friends. This is a small enough industry, so we're all people who go back a long way with each other. So happy to share this forum with all of them. I'm Srinivas Raghavan. I work with Sundaram Finance. I've spent, most of my working life with Sundaram Finance, and I've been in this industry for now closing in on 40 years. So some people want to be nice to me, they call me a veteran of this industry. The truth is that they're saying you're an old man, and that's fine with me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. T.T. Srinivas Raghavan, that It's always a blessing to have the presence of veterans of the industry with us. I think your speech will be enlightening for all of us. In the meantime, before I move to Mr. George, Dr. Ravi Gupta, CEO of Illustrate Technomedia, has just now messaged us that he is down with severe back pain and neck pain. He cannot join us, but he wishes all the success for this webinar and he sends his wishes to all the eminent panelists. With this, we move to Mr. George Alexander, okay. Managing Director, Muthoot Group. Mr. Muthoot, if you can kindly give a small brief about you and your company.
Thank you. Glad to be again, as TTS said, to be with the friends. I'm happy to be here. About myself, George Alexander Muthoot, youngest of the four promoter directors of the family, which looks after the Muthoot Group. Our interest mainly is in the 90% is into the gold loan sector, and another 10% probably in the home finance, microfinance, and the vehicle finance sector. Of course, just as, although not a veteran as TTS, around 40 years plus, my contribution also, or my experience in this industry. Glad to be here. Welcome to all of you.
Pleasure to have you, Mr. Muthoot, with us.
Thank you
so much. Mr. Prabhakar Bobde, Chief Executive Officer, Sustainable Agro Commercial Finance Limited. If you can just give a small brief about your company and your present portfolio.
Yeah. So thank you, Souvik. Thank you, listener. I'm Prabhakar Bobde. I'm representing Safal Sustainable Agriculture Finance Company Limited. So this company is eight years old company, and we are into agribusiness in SME business and retail business in Maharashtra, MP, and Karnataka. Regarding myself, I am in finance for last 30 years. I was a banker. I came to NBFCs 2 years back. So now learning from all my senior colleagues, George sir, TT sir, and Raman sir, as well as Sachin. Thank you for having me here. Thank you.
Pleasure hosting you, Mr. Bobde. We move to a special guest from from Hinduja Leyland Finance, Chief Executive Officer, Mr. Sachin Pillai. Mr. Pillai, if you can just give a brief about your company and your current portfolio.
Not audible.
You have to unmute yourself. Unmute, you are muted.
Can you unmute yourself, please?
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Sachin Pillai. I represent Hinduja Leyland Finance. We are a company which is in the business, largely in the vehicle financing segment. However, we have a good presence in certain non-vehicle financing asset categories as well, like loan-based property. We also have a small portfolio where we buy out books of other smaller NBFCs, and we also have a presence in the affordable housing finance segment. So that's largely where the company is present. Possibly, we are the youngest among all the panelists out here in terms of being in business for 10 years. I think I'm the last and the youngest in among the esteemed panel members also in terms of the experience and the kind of number of years that we've put into this business. I've been in asset-based financing for almost now 25 years in the past, being associated with Ashok Leyland Finance, City Bank, HDFC Bank, and being part of Hinduja Leyland Finance since 2012. Very happy to be part of this panel today among the esteemed panelists.
Thank you so much, Mr. Pillai. As you're saying, you perhaps may be the youngest, but we have the veteran also. So as we say that to move on in life, we need the mix of both experience and youthness. I think that is also true for NBFC sectors. So with this, I move on to the first question to our panelists. We all know that we're all living in unprecedented times. So perhaps modern human history has not witnessed this kind of unprecedented times, courtesy COVID-19 and the lockdown. I know it has affected all of us, you, me, all the citizens in the country, be it in urban space, be it in rural space. It has impacted all the industry. It has impacted more the financial and economic industry most, apart from manufacturing and others. But my first question will be, what is the scenario of NBFCs in the present situation of COVID and lockdown, and how the NBFCs can reintroduce themselves or reimagine themselves post COVID-19? we can start with Mr. Raman Agarwal, co-chairman, Finance Industry Development Council.
Thank you, Sovik. So yes, as you said, I mean, NBFC sector is no different. The whole world is affected. Everything is in kind of a shut mode currently. And it has impacted and it a big way the NBFC sector. However, what is really critical to understand is that the class of borrowers to whom NBFC is we sitting in the, you know, and I see all the panelists here cater to is a segment who are the real small time business people, you know, so be it a auto rickshaw driver, a small tempo driver, a truck driver who's owning one vehicle, an e-rickshaw driver, a small shopkeeper, what we can also broadly constitute as the entire MSME segment or the segment which is largely not unbanked or underbanked are the segments to whom NBFCs have been known to catering to providing credit. Now, these people are the worst affected by this COVID-driven lockdown. The lockdown means everything comes to a standstill. The first thing to be affected is all people-to-people movement is shut. So whether it's inter-country, we have travel industry, we interstate, you know, intercity, intra-city, local transportation, everything is shut. The moment that thing happens, obviously the sectors directly related or even all other sectors which are indirectly related get impacted. And majority of them are the class of borrowers to whom we cater to. So it's a big blow, undoubtedly, yes. But let me just quickly in my opening remarks state that we are confident as a body and as a sector. I think we have seen many, many I would say challenges, people call them whirlpools, overhauling, whatever you may call it. And NBFC sector each time has come out and come out stronger. I have no doubt in my mind that yes, we shall come out of this crisis also and come out strong.
Yeah, true. I think whenever there's a challenge, it also comes with opportunity. I think as you rightly said, that this unprecedented challenge will actually perhaps help the NBFC sector with other sectors to redefine themselves. And they will come with some solution soon enough. Thank you, Mr. Agarwal. I'll put the same question to Mr. T.T. Srinivas Raghavan, Managing Director, Sundaram Finance. How do you analyze the present economic and financial situation for the COVID-19 scenario and especially for the NBFC sector, being a veteran of this industry for so many years?
Shovik, just for convenience, I think it's easier for you to just call me TTS because my name is a mouthful. So, TTS is
thanks
fine.
For helping me.
I think let's be real, okay? I think however long you've been in this industry, how many ever other crises you've seen, none of that I think matters today because this, as you rightly said, is unprecedented. Nobody in living memory has seen anything like this. So past experience will help, but it will only help to a limited extent. Because I think the magnitude, I think, of disruption this time is something nobody can remember. Because unlike earlier crises, which hit selected pockets of society or industry, this one has hit across the board, right? Rich, poor, young, old, male, female, no distinctions, right? I mean, in a sense, this is the most egalitarian or socialist pandemic, right? Or event that it has spared no one. It is not discriminated on the basis of anything. Right? Therefore, the impact of this thing is quite phenomenal. And truth to tell, I don't believe any of us can put our hands on our hearts and say, I know the answer to what lies ahead. I will be perfectly truthful and honest and say, I don't know what lies ahead. What I do know is what Raman said, that as an industry, we have been resilient in the past. We've met other crises. We've met economic crises. We've met regulatory crises. We've lived through many of those crises. But as I say, that guarantees nothing, but it does give us confidence that having lived through some really rough times in the past, we will this time too. Of course, it's going to take a lot more work. It's going to take probably a serious toll in terms of, you know, the longevity of some entities. So there could be some mortality. All of those things will happen. But at the end of it all, whenever that may be, I believe that NBFCs will emerge from this. They will emerge stronger from this because, as Raman said, for a large section of this country's population, NBFCs are the lifeline, right? And so for their sake and for the sake of this economy, I do hope that we will come through this and come through this stronger.
Right, right. We all have to be optimistic to move forward. Thank you, Mr. TTS, as you have helped me to say that I can call you as TTS instead of TT Srinivas Raghavan, Managing Director, Sundaram Finance Limited. With this, we move to Mr. George Alexander Muthoot, Managing Director, Muthoot Group. Mr. George.
thank you.
Just to interrupt Mr. Muthoot for once, I request Mr. Raman Agarwal, if you can kindly switch on his video because I think his video is not visible. Yeah, yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah, Mr. George Alexander Muthoot.
Sure. Raman, we would like to see you, so don't switch off your video. So, George Alexander here. I fully agree with what Raman said and what TT has said. But of course, I don't want to repeat what they said because I fully endorse whatever they said. But what comes to my mind, see, I don't have a solution, etc. But what comes to my mind is probably something which I would like to share here with you. See, today, till the last 15 days, last 10 days, the last 40 days, we were all speaking about how the industry is going. Every industry is going from bad to worse, how the industry is affected. Some will take 2 months to survive, some will take 5 months, some will take a year. So nothing positive has been spoken till now about this. Not that I have anything positive in this matter, but I would only like to say that it's now time that we started giving confidence to the public about this pandemic and its impact. Because today, if you talk, everybody will say negative only. The industry is coming down, this industry is coming down, this will not survive, vehicle vans will not, travel will not be there, etc., etc. But let us try to give, first of all, some confidence. So in that, in the last 3 days, the newspapers and in the government releases, I see that the government is also now veering a little bit to talking about how the economy also has to be looked after. Just we were till now looking after the health of the people. Now the economy is also to be looked after. Now I think I see a little bit of positiveness coming from the government on that side. That itself will give some confidence to us. So what I feel is that if it is the economy which needs to survive, if it's the businesses which needs to survive, and the people who needs to prosper, we have to prosper. So today, if you say last 40 days, nobody is spending any money. Everybody is just taking some water, no travel, no expenses, nothing. But that doesn't prop up any economy. So for that, all these other things, travel, cinema, everything has to come back. It is not coming back today. So I think, first of all, a confidence has to come in the minds of people. So we, at the industry level, at the top level also, we need to, from our reactions, from our actions, from our, from people who work below us, they should also get some confidence that, yes, the health problems are there, pandemic is there, but there is some light at the end of the tunnel, and we and the industry and the business and the economy can grow. I have a few suggestions for that, probably. What comes to my mind, if you want, I can tell it now, or in the next round, I can tell you. It's up to the panelist or the or Mr. Sovik too.
Yeah, Mr. Muthus will come to the suggestions part for government or for the regulators because we all.
My limited point here is that yes, let us now start looking at the economic activities. Let us now start giving some confidence to the people, to the government, to the people that yes, the economy has to survive. We all have to survive. We all have to prosper. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Muthu. Taking cue from what you have said, that it's all about coming back to life, the famous song. And I hope we all will come back to life soon and will surpass this unprecedented times soon enough. So with this, we move to Mr. Prabhakar Bobde, Chief Executive Officer, Sustainable Agro-Commercial Finance Limited. Mr. Bobde, your take on this situation.
Yeah, thank you, Sovik. What we feel is after, I'll not repeat what TTS sir or Aman sir or George sir has told. I endorse all their views. What are the different challenges and what are the different opportunities we see to this? So basically after epidemic, within all of us, we have been close the branches and all negativity has been there into the organizations as well as market also. So once what we can see is after 17th April, government has allowed us to open some branches. From 20th April, we opened some locations, some branches. That really has given some positive part. Because let us go back from 23rd of March, there was a Janta curfew, and 25th onwards or 26th onwards, there was a lockdown. So 20th April, we really opened some 60-70 branches in rural part of the India, which is really gave some trust. Okay, we have opened only 50% time or 8 to 2. That is also fine. And thanks to the government, they included NBFCs into the necessary services. So because of that, it gave clarity to at a ground level so that they allowed NBFC to work on the lines of the banks. Earlier, they were not allowing. That is positive part. So looking at this from 3rd May, if more number of locations are open and we can open the branches and start the business, that is really very good. And I hope, I am very confident that trust will come. How many days it will take to come? Yes, there is a challenge. Nobody can predict that. But all of us has to be positive because all of us, we are seniors and we have a team to take care. We have to take care of their families and everything. That is my first take. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Bobde. Thank you, Mr. Yeah. Bobde. This is a practical, pragmatic approach to the sector and the point of discussion, what you have just said. I will have more detailed discussion on this in the latter half of the webinar. With this, maybe move to Mr. Sachin Pillai, Chief Executive Officer, Hinduja Leyland Finance. Your take on this, Mr. Pillai?
Yeah, I mean, I know as most of the panelists have already kind of elaborated in terms of the pandemic being unprecedented, possibly none of us in this present generation as well as the earlier generation would have ever seen this. And obviously, the realization across the world is that there's no silver bullet to solve this problem. You have to go through it. And therefore, I feel the same applies for the NBFC segment also. There is a high degree of uncertainty. The initial reaction was obviously to look at the Jan part of it or the life part of it. Now, obviously, the realization is coming in to look at the livelihood part of it also, the Jahan part of it also, which is very good. So, which also gives an indication that within the system, the fear psychosis, which was the initial reaction, for very rightly so, because we have not seen this in the past. And now, the realization of getting back into the work and getting the economy back rolling is something which, as a system, it's kind of getting recognized. And I'm sure that therefore steps would be taken on those lines. However, having said that, today none of us possibly have the capability to put a finger to say, the depth of this disruption, the length which it will last through, what kind of recovery is going to come through, whether it is a V-shaped or a U-shaped or a bumpy one, or put any alphabet to that. So, and obviously all this is going to lead to a lot of contraction as far as, the overall economic activity across the globe is concerned, and that, for that matter, even India. There are data to say that India might be relatively unaffected, but still, what we have not seen in the past 40 years or maybe 50 years of our existence is something that possibly we will be staring at least in the current financial year. So yeah, these times are unprecedented, and you know, will require us to, since there's no precedence, we require us to, you know, look at it day to day kind of evolution of things, and then possibly, you know, try to get a grid to have a short to medium term view formed, and then, you know, look at how the long term can be. All of us possibly in the last 2 months of the last financial year would have made plans for the current year, which has all now gone out of the window. And now, you know, we are grappling with a situation where we don't know how things are going to turn out. There are no possible triggers also which are kind of indicating in terms of how the growth would come back, or you know, how the stability would come back in each of the asset categories that we are present. Obviously, you know, this period, you know, becomes very important for us, therefore, to be, you know, highly engaged. The level of engagement with our employees and the customers and in our channel partners becomes very important during this period, not only from a perspective of giving them comfort, confidence, and, you know, making them come out of the, you know, the fear, but also to have an understanding of what is happening in their own sphere of life, in their own sphere of action or activity or business in which they are involved, because that kind of gives you very valid inputs to form a view and also help them and ourselves come out of this situation. That I feel is the most important aspect that, you know, one should be focusing on as we, you know, go through this process. Obviously, you know, right now most of the assumptions to, you know, look at how the future will, you know, kind of turn out to be, the basis are very, very weak. The foundation is not there. So it is more to do with what information we gather, and therefore this engagement with the ground becomes extremely important. And that is something I feel is, you know, very critical during this phase.
Right. Thanks, Mr. Pillai. Your opening remark was quite insightful. And as we have already, all our five panelists have touched upon various important factors of the problems we are facing as an NBFC sector as a whole. But I think the biggest problem will be of liquidity crunch. We know that about debt of rupees 2.5 lakh crore is coming up for redemption by June. And only maybe large NBFCs will be able to access the RBI's TLTRO window. So, Mr. Agarwal, what is your take? As you're representing Finance Industry Development Council, we know in June, more than 2 lakh crore is due for redemption. And if you talk about TLTR, only big NBFCs will be able to go for it. What about the small and medium-sized NBFCs? How they are going to manage this liquidity crunch?
See, as you said, you know, already before this COVID happened, we were already, you know, working about creating liquidity and funding support for, as you rightly said, especially for the small and medium NBFCs. Because we all know that ever since ILFS happened in 2018, liquidity has been a challenge. Now, let's look at it this way. While, you know, I always tend to, you know, say that things sometimes get blown out of proportion, and to presume that suddenly we are going to see a scenario that there'll be defaults happening left and right, I don't see that happening. There are challenges. And coming to the specific point of TLTRO, while it was the intent of the regulator was very appreciable, because perhaps for the first time, such a targeted approach was taken, where a specified quantum of the funding was meant and earmarked for small and medium NBFCs, right? I think never it has happened in history. There used to be the general liquidity operations being done. But, you know, it's the risk averse attitude on the part of the banks, which is really, what should I say, is the factor. Right or wrong is something for the bankers to decide. I think we are nobody to take a call on that. But the fact of the matter remains that today, even today as we talk, there is more than 7 lakh crores of rupees lying with RBI in reverse repo, which is an excess liquidity in the system, but not trickled out. In spite of TLTRO 2, the response was very tepid, because banks are not ready to take that kind of risk when they say as it comes. So actually, the real pain comes for the small and medium NBFCs. See, let's look at it this way. Not many of the small and medium-sized NBFCs access capital market. For them, the major and perhaps the only source of funding is bank funding. So So, you know, it for them, it's either a simple term loan or a working capital CC limit, which they have from banks, is what they are dependent on. The moment there is this risk averseness on the part of banks, obviously the pain is felt most by the small and medium enterprises. So we have been representing, and that's the, I think, and we just as latest as yesterday, represented once again to, you know, the Finance Ministry and RBI, requesting that perhaps, I think, there is a serious, needs to be a serious relook in terms of providing a direct credit line. It could be by way of a refinance mechanism, whether Mudra does it, SIDBI does it, NABARD does it, or some other body does it, or we create an SPV, as there is a talk about in the system. And to give some comfort, there could be some kind of a guarantee offered by the government. Once again, not to the so-called bonds or NCDs issued, but perhaps even to instruments like term loans. So if there is a, some kind of a guarantee given, it could add comfort. All in all put together, the sum and substance of the issue lies that yes, banks are risk averse, banks have liquidity, but because of this, it is not trickly down to the small and medium NBFCs. Banks have funded and are funding the big ones. So I think there is a need to look at an alternate mechanism for the small and medium ones. That is my take on this liquidity issue.
Right, right. Quite an insightful analysis of the problem of liquidity crunch and steps taken by RBI and big and small medium NBFCs. Mr. TTS, what's your take on how it is going to impact, or how it is impacting? I'm wrong to say how it's going to impact, because it has already started impacting. How it is impacting the small and medium NBFCs who are actually giving services to the huge section of the society who are basically unbanked or unfinanced, and they are getting all the services through NBFCs. How they're going to manage this problem of liquidity crunch?
There's two sides to this problem, Shovik. One is on the asset side, the other is on the liability side, right? Because as George said, as the economy moves back on track, we need something, you know, to get the economy moving. And for that, you need small businesses, especially need funding. And the guys who fund the small businesses are the NBFCs, right? So you need capital, which will basically trigger growth in the economy. On the other side, the NBFCs also need the money to do this funding, but a lot of their liquidity also comes from their collections. Now, unfortunately, we're in a situation of moratorium where I would say for most NBFCs, especially the smaller NBFCs, 100% of their customers would have availed the moratorium. So there is no inflow of money happening to them by way of collections. And if there is also no money coming from any other source, whether it's the banks or anyone else, then effectively their liability side is shut, right? So how are they going to go out and do any fresh business? So this is actually the conundrum now, right? You could argue that, you know, if they don't need to lend, they don't need to borrow, but that's not how the economy is going to move forward, right? So it is absolutely critical for us to break this vicious cycle, and which is where, as Raman said, we've been sort of passionately putting forth the case to the regulator, to the government, to anyone who will listen, that it is critically important to grease these wheels. Because unless we get this thing moving, the revival, the reimagining, whatever is the jargon you want to use, is not going to happen. Because you need capital to fund growth, right? And if that is not forthcoming, we can keep talking for hours together. We can keep having webinars, seminars. Nothing is going to happen. We need to find a way to break this flux and put money into the hands of NBFC so that they can in turn go out and start, feeding those who need it the most.
True, Mr. TTS. And I'll just add to what you have said that it's all about starting the wheel again. And it's, as you said, only webinars, events, and will be of value, but we need action on ground. And for that, I'd like to inform you and all the esteemed panelists and all the attendees that we will be documenting the entire webinar outcome and will be circulating to stakeholders, be it regulatory body, be it government, be it other stakeholders, so that the outcome of this discussion is being heard by the right stakeholders, so that a positive discussion, positive step can be taken to move the economy ahead. And as you rightly said, that the ball has to start rolling again. But it's also a problem for government, for all of us. So what to, it's like a double-edged sword, like what to do, to save lives or to save livelihoods. I think that's the biggest problem we all are facing. And I think, I'm sure government is working on that to make a balance so that some of the operations are starting in near future. What's your take, Mr. Muthoot, on this situation of liquidity crunch for NBFCs?
Thank you. I think the liquidity crunch today, what everybody speaks is that Reserve Bank is willing to give money to the NBFCs, to the TLTRO, but not directly to the NBFCs, through the bank. And the bank is not prepared to take the credit risk. That's the biggest problem. That's why no bank is giving any NBFC, because they don't want to be saddled with a bad loan or a bad account. So they are being very overcautious. I think one suggestion would be, we have this NPA classification of 90 days. Earlier, if my memory was correct, it was 180 days. 3-4 years back, the Reserve Bank brought it down gradually, 180, 150, 120, 90. They brought it down to 90. But today, looking at this scenario, I think it is time we increase that 90 to probably not even 120, not even 180, little more, maybe little more than 180 days, so that loans given by the NBFCs do not become an NPA quickly. Once it becomes an NPA quickly, their balance sheet goes for a toss. And when their balance sheet and NPA goes for a toss, the banks who have funded them are in problem. So why not we increase this 90 days to 180 or even to 270 days? And also one more rider, that it should not be brought back to 90 at one go. It should be eased slowly. If you have reached 240 or 270, bring it down 30 days every quarter or something like this, so that the industry gets time. Otherwise, all these industry, MSME, everybody, all these industries, enterprises will become an NPA, and banks will be saddled with this NPA. So why not change that? Is the one very easy and simple thing that can be done. If we kill all these enterprises, it will be very difficult to restart it once again. Now, on a very macroeconomic like thinking, we are also thinking that some industries or manufacturing will come from China to India, etc. But if that time, if you have killed all these small industries, who is going to get that work? So one thing immediately and quickly we can do easily, without much problem we can do, is that to make this. So if by that some industries are surviving, some NBFCs are surviving, it will be easier for them to access capital, either through bank or otherwise. This is one simple solution which I have for this, which I think we should put some pressure on the regulator to get this thing done, so that bank funding, banks can fund easily these people. The second thing is the demand has to, for demand to come, there should be purchasing power in the hands of people. That is not an NBFC problem alone. That is a total country's problem. Unless you put purchasing power in the hands of people, this economy cannot grow. So how do you put purchasing power in the hands of people? If you have the labor should be paid money. Whether how long can a factory or an enterprise which is not working pay full salaries? If it is 15 days, 30 days, yes. If it goes to 40 days, 60 days, now today states are working with each other to extend the lockdown. one fellow says, I'm going to bring down the lockdown after 15th. Another says, I will do it only after 20th. They are afraid. So whether the government should put in some money in the hands of people. One easiest method for that is one, to release all these pending payments. There are such a lot of pending payments by government which has to be released. That is for the corps. The organized sector can easily give, you have registered Provident Fund holders, registered ESI holders, give them 10,000, 15,000 rupees to them. Just a gift, 1 month, 2 months. Look at England. All the companies which have closed, they have said your employees can go on furlough. If you go on furlough, 80% of the salary is paid by the government. We had a very small company employing about 20 people there. Yesterday, we received a check for £35,000. That is 80% to be given to this. So unless government thinks of printing money. So I read in today's paper, I think it's a Malayalam paper, I read that people are thinking of printing money. Printing money means putting money either in quantitative easing, like what do you call it in Western countries, quantitative easing, or here just putting more and more money in the hands of government and the people. So this is unorganized sector. You have Jan Dhan accounts. Please give money to all the Jan Dhan account people. This will create a little bit of inflation, but it will perk up the economy. It will perk up the economy. Probably small inflation can happen, but the demand is there. This is what I think the economy should do, the RBI should do, to, as TTS said, to grease the wheels so that it starts rolling again. We'll always be talking negativity, and we will kill all these industries. We'll kill livelihood of all these people. This is my take on this.
Very important take by Mr. Muthoot. And as you were saying, it reminds me of a statement given by Mr. Abhijit Banerjee, the Nobel laureate, who has recently said that if necessary, government should print more and more currency to ensure that cash is there and money is there during this period. And he said this is the best time to do that. Maybe we can differ on that, or economists can differ on that. But I think I'm getting the similarity between what Mr. Abhijit Banerjee has said and Mr. Muthoot is saying. One is, let's not go to that direction where NBFCs get more and more NPs. And we have to ensure the ball is rolling and people have money in their hand. Maybe 90 days to 120 days, that can be an option. What's your take, Mr. Bobde, CEO, Sustainable Agro Commercial Finance Limited?
I'll split it into two points. One is liquidity to NBFCs, and another is cash flow of the borrower is to pay the loans, as well as to how he will go to the livelihood. Means until now he was working for life, now he'll go to livelihood. How it should work, as rightly said Mr. George, that some of the countries, they are depositing money into the accounts of the companies. Even US is giving interest free or loan, or just like incentive to the companies of MSME of around $10,000 or something, or they are creating money of $1,400 into the individual account. Even Indians who are working there, even boys who have gone 1 year back and completed MS and doing service or part-time service, they also got $1,400 in their account. So whether our country affords it, it is a million-dollar question. I think let economists discuss on that. Because as a common man, India has a per capita income of $2,000 as compared to US has a $60,000. So it is a different argument altogether. So regarding NBFCs, what we are doing? We are doing, government has given moratorium. We are giving moratorium to all our borrowers, but we are not getting moratorium. Until now, government is not clear, or banks are not clear. Government is cleared, but banks are not clear, because they are still in dilemma whether if I give the moratorium, whether same thing will be delayed, or they don't want to do 10% additional provisional 5% in graded environment. That is also one of the point. But on part of the NBFC, yes, we are delaying our cash flow by 3 months, but we have to pay our liability on due date. Means April, May, I have to pay my liability even though I don't have cash flow coming due to moratorium, which was rightly said by TTS sir also. So these were the challenge we are facing. So no doubt we are going to the banks. So what banks are saying, yes, we'll give you money provided we get some comfort from the government. So they are looking for rightly Raman sir said, they are looking for the FLDG that government should go at least 25% or 10%. So on that basis, they can give the same lending, additional lending of 20-25% of the working capital limit to the existing NBFC borrowers, which will be comfortable to them because they know that these are the NBFCs who were never defaulted. Okay. This part on the NBFC side, on liquidity side. So we are the people, we are not able to raise the money, but we have to pay our liabilities to the bankers. Then how we can improve this after COVID also? Borrower should have, or a MSME or a farmer should have some money in his hand. How can he, farmer now, let us take as a rural economy or agrarian economy. Agriculture now next he will get money in the month of October only. Rabi crop is harvested. Now Mondays are started. He will get money now. Now after Kharif plantation, he will get money in October only. So till October, what people will do, what organization will do. So for this, I think RBI has to come forward and look at a one-time restructuring. Big restructuring has to happen. Otherwise, it will impact the balance sheets of NBFCs. And if government want to put money into MSMEs who are loyal GST payers, as well as who are not eligible for GSTs, but they are availing loans through NBFCs, which is a normal regulated channel of the country. Government, if they want to put money, give money to MSME, they can give through NBFCs, because NBFC has a far better reach than the bank. So NBFC is the best channel for government to push money into the bottom of the pyramid. So how they can do it? Yes, they can do it through SPV or some direct line to the direct credit line to the NBFCs. These are the 2 points I feel. Then other countries, one more point I want to say is some of the countries like US, they have released their 20% of GDP into the economy. So how much we are ready to release? So so that is the big debate we have to start. And as Raman sir said, that India is doing this epidemic in graded parameter. It is not giving impetus in full one stroke, but government of India is giving in graded parameter. Whenever it is required, it is pushing. So I think we have to again go to the government, ask for these 2-3 things to help the NBFCs which are less than 500 and smaller MFIs and even NBFCs for their survival. Because without that, right now, as TTS said also, they are surviving on repayments, and collection has gone down to 10-15% in last 1.5 months. So whatever we are collecting, it has gone down to 15-20%. On that 15-20% collection, operation cost cannot be survived for longer period. Then other challenges will come, cost control will come. So all these challenges has to be curtailed. I think government has to come forward and give some FLDG to the bankers, so that bankers will be more comfortable on giving loans to their existing borrowers. I think this is my take. Thank you.
Very important points cropped up by Mr. Bobde. RBI has to come forward, government has to come forward, and I think we'll move on to that kind of discussion. We have Mr. Agarwal with us. He can shed some light on that as well. But very important and pertinent point raised by you, that you're talking about moratorium. Customers are getting moratorium, but NBFCs are giving moratorium to customers. But what about the NBFCs getting some relief from banks? And when NBFCs are going to banks, banks are saying, what about us? So we have to bridge all these gaps so that a comprehensive relief package, which is, has been announced by Government of India, actually is felt on the ground zero. I think that we all have to look at, and I think government is, I'm sure government is looking at it. Mr. Pillai, what's your take on this topic of the cash crunch, liquidity crunch, especially for small and medium NBFCs?
Yeah, look, you know, we my earlier panelists have already touched upon the fact in terms of, you know, what role we look at RBI to play or the Ministry of Finance to play. Now, I look at it in a manner that, you know, you have one on the hand, your Ministry of Finance as an entity, RBI as an entity, banks as an entity, and the NBFCs as an entity. Now, here, I think Ministry of Finance, you know, has come out, and as Mr. Pope rightly pointed out, in a progressive manner, the, you know, stimulus is kind of, you know, being declared. We have seen one round happening, and we are kind of expecting that, you know, in the near future, we'll see, you know, another rounds coming in. Similarly, we have seen RBI also reacting much proactively in terms of, you know, coming out with the liquidity kind of a package to the TLTRO route. And for whatever reasons, they are looking at banks to play the role of an intermediary in this to, you know, channelize the liquidity through the banks. And while, you know, in other economies across the world, we have seen regulators taking a much more proactive stance in going ahead and doing it on their own. For whatever reasons here, you know, RBI is looking at the through for that to happen through the banks. And banks are not comfortable. So the need, what we need to address is to give comfort to the banks, and therefore the engagement with banks in terms of, you know, on a maybe on a collective basis or individual basis. In our own experience over the last, you know, 3-4 weeks, we have been reaching out to all our banks, and we have got a very good response in terms of, you know, even yesterday we had a interaction with one of the larger banks with the MD, the EDs and the GMs participating in the call, and, you know, we had a 1.5 hour, you know, discussion, and, you know, kind of throwing light into in terms of how do we see the things moving as far as our customer segment, our asset class is concerned, how are we placed as a company, and we are seeing, you know, encouraging kind of, you know, outcomes coming out of that. I feel, you know, obviously we need to keep, you know, taking up this with the regulator, with the Ministry of Finance, but equally important to engage with the banks individually or collectively and giving them that comfort. Now, let me flip it across and give you an example. As I told you, we have a small book where we lend to NBFCs that, you know, today we have almost close to 160 originators out there. Now, almost all of them, we have been in touch with them, you know, in the last 5 weeks. And we have done a stress test across, you know, all these NBFCs to see, you know, how are they faring in the current scenario and what kind of cash is what they're sitting on for, how many months they have a cover for. And accordingly looked at, you know, bucketing each NBFC and then looking at, you know, how do we go out and, you know, ensure. Because end of the day, they going down has a ramification on the portfolio. And therefore, end of the day, at a systemic level, any of the NBFCs going down has a, you know, ramification on the overall, you know, credit portfolio of the bank. So I guess, you know, engaging with the banks is very important because they today don't have the comfort. They are looking at it more from a credit risk perspective rather than liquidity as a solution for liquidity. And therefore, to give them that comfort and getting them on board becomes very important. Obviously, in the absence of that, they are looking at the government to give some kind of a guarantee or some kind of a backstop for them, which may happen, which might not happen. It might take time. We are running very, you know, we are running very precarious on time. We have already seen 6 weeks of the lockdown get through. We have already seen moratoriums not getting passed on. The you know, end customer is already, you know, availing the moratorium. There is a gap which is coming in, and which every passing day, this gap is becoming wider and wider. So, you know, from the NBFC or from the industry standpoint, I feel that engagement with the bankers are going to be much more critical in this period to get them on board, to get them the comfort, to, you know, share all the data and inputs with them, maybe, as I told you, individually or as an industry body, and then, you know, move forward. I think that's where the, you know, one of the possible, you know, approaches would kind of, you know, give a better solution. I also agree with Mr. Murthy's point to say that, you know, the 90-day NPA recognition, while we got a 3-month moratorium which got announced after the lockdown, where the visibility was that, you know, we might come out of a lockdown after April 15th. Now, that not happening, you know, obviously, you know, we would be looking at a window to come in. Whether it is 90 going to 180 or more in line with the effects of the pandemic being there, and then, you know, maybe on a graded way, it can be brought down back to 90. from 180 to 150 to 120 to 90 over the next few quarters, or else we can look at a window where a one-time window of restructuring of all the client loans can be made permissible by the RBI, and therefore we can kind of address the cash flow situation, which is kind of adverse right now, or a combination of both is something which we as the NBFC industry today would be looking at as far as underlying cash flows on the customers are concerned.
Yeah, thanks, thanks, Mr. Pillai, for raising some pragmatic and practical points that raising of this NPA time from 90 to 120 days or 180 days. Just to inform all of our esteemed panelists that we have more than 300 participants, live participants in this webinar now. It is being broadcasted in Facebook, so I think hundreds and thousands of views and likes will come subsequently. I can see list of questions already been asked. Almost 20-25 questions has been asked by our viewers. I think we have covered many aspects in last 1 hour or so. Because there's so many attendees and there are so many questions, I think we can come to the last end of this webinar discussion before we go on to Q&A. Maybe we can have one note on how, what is the future for NBFC sector, and how the digital aspect or the digital transformation will take a front seat, or whether it will take a front seat in coming months or years. With this, we can move on to Mr. Raman Agarwal. Mr. Agarwal, your take on the future of NBFCs post-lockdown, post-COVID era in India, with a special focus on digitization and technology.
So as I said, yes, we will not come out, we will come out stronger. And the role of NBFCs is perhaps going to be enhanced, because we, as I said, all these small-time people, we are the worst affected. They would certainly need more funding support, credit support. And as TTS sir also said, who's going to provide credit to them? It's going to be the NBFCs. And I think the government fully realizes this, recognizes this. And going forward, so whenever there is talk about MSMEs, there is also talk about NBFCs, because NBFCs are the ones who's going to fund them. Having said that, in terms of the way we do business, the way things are done, we are going to witness some structural changes. Digital certainly is going to be the order of the day and will play a very big role, whether it's in terms of digital discussions, just we're doing a webinar instead of a seminar, or we see the digital payment systems, because you will have more and more of that being promoted. And as we also see a new opportunity, which has just cropped up out of this crisis, is the work from home opportunity, which is again based purely on technology. And I think that itself is going to throw up huge employment opportunities across the country for people in remote areas, even for the women folk who are forced to stay home taking care of small children or elderlies. So that again is going to be a big structural change. And digital is going to be the order of the day. It's going to play a far, far bigger role. So the stress on the telecommunication, the internet is going to be all the more. And I think government needs to ensure a high quality and more investment in these sectors, which I think is already on the way. So we will see a big transformation in the way businesses are done. And NBFC specifically, since we are in financial intermediaries, we borrow money, we lend money, a lot of digital transactions are going to take place. But our requirement in the system, I only see an enhanced role being played post-COVID.
That can be an ideal concluding statement. Enhancing role of NBFCs in post-COVID era. Thank you, Mr. Agarwal. Mr. Raman Agarwal, Co-Chairman, Finance Industry Development Council. I move to Mr. TTS, Managing Director, Sundaram Finance Limited. Your end note for the future of NBFCs in India, and also how digital transformation will be playing a major role in that.
I'd just like to move slightly away from what's the future of NBFCs. It's no doubt an important question to ask, but I think the question really should be, what is the future of small businesses in this country? What is the business of small entrepreneurs? Because really, if you look at this whole discussion, it is about, you know, the bottom of the pyramid. And I don't know what the statistic is, but the Indian economy is so hugely dependent on what we call the unorganized sector. Sure. Right? So whether it's the MFIs or it's the small NBFCs or the large NBFCs or the banks, right? A lot of our resources finally do go to fund the small guys, right? So if not NBFC, who, right? It's a question that needs to be asked and that needs to be answered. And here, it's been the case of the industry, and we've made this point to the government, to the regulator a number of times. What we really need is a model of wholesaler and retailer. And I'll take a second to explain that. Banks have all the ability and the strength to raise resources, right? So they are essentially the wholesalers in terms of liabilities. In terms of credit delivery, it is the NBFCs who, because of their nimbleness, because of their understanding of risk, because of their understanding of local conditions, are able to deliver and collect, right, in these typically small clusters and geographies, which is why MFIs have succeeded, which is why historically NBFCs have succeeded. So I think we need to look at NBFCs not as something standalone. NBFCs are a very, very important cog in the wheel of financial inclusion. If financial inclusion has to become a reality, if the bottom of the pyramid in this country really has to be served, then NBFCs become a very, very important cog. Below the NBFCs are the MFIs, right? So each one of us has an important role to play. Each one of us has a very vital contribution to make. So this is, I don't think we should narrow our scope and talk only about NBFCs. We should talk about a much wider canvas of, you know, what happens to small business in this country, right? And what is the role of NBFCs in that? I think if we did that, we'll get a much broader canvas and we will get much better solutions. That's part one. As far as digital is concerned, yes, I mean, I hear everyone saying digital, 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 this is where the world is going. But let's also be realistic. People in this country, especially the bottom of the pyramid that we're talking about, they need to get familiar, they need to get comfortable, right, with dealing digitally. Similarly, lenders need to get comfortable lending, because our business models have typically been based on face-to-face contact. It's been based on personal knowledge of customers, so on and so forth. So if you're going to take everything digital, essentially, a large part of it will mean depersonalizing the experience. Certainly, yes, there is a case to be made to move digital, but let's not kid ourselves that it's going to happen overnight. It's a good end desire to have. It's good to set the thing in motion so that over time we're able to achieve it. But if we expect that some magic wand will turn all NBFC business digital in the next month or the next quarter or in the next year, I think we're living in a little bit of la-la land, right? So that's my quick 2 bits on
digital. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. TTS. Yes, we are all part of the society. And when you're talking about NBFCs, we're surely talking about the intersection and now in that section, NBFCs are also working. Thank you so much for shedding some light on that. Mr. George Muthut, your take on the future of NBFCs vis-a-vis the overall economic situation in India.
Thank you. I think I fully agree with TTS when he said NBFCs are required for sustaining the businesses, whatever the individual business, small business, at the lower end of the pyramid. So that is required. Second, about the, again, I agree with him about the digital transformation. You can't have a digital transformation overnight, these type of customers. NBFC's their strength is in meeting face-to-face with the customer and being able to take a decision whether to lend or to collect. If that is taken away from an NBFC, what is the need for an NBFC then? So NBFC is there to stay, and digital, yes, good to have after some time, but still it will take long time for all these customers first to come face to face to the lender and borrower should come face to face. They should be able to assess each other and then give the loan or get the collections. It will take maybe not only some quarters, some few couple of, not couple, even 5-10 years for these type of customers to become digital. Yes, slowly we can start. But then the role of NBFCs is in dealing with directly with the customer. If you take it out, then you need only an Amazon or something like that, or some digital company. There is no need of an NBFC. Then you don't, I don't think you don't call them as NBFC. So it will take time, but digital change should be there. But don't wish it, don't expect it to come probably to me in the next 5-10 years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. George Muthoot, for giving us a picture of hope for near future for the NBFC sector. We move to Mr. Bob, the Chief Executive Officer, Sustainable Agro Commercial Finance Limited. Mr. Bobde, your take on the role of NBFCs, and if I may so also touch on special focus on the agro sector, the role of NBFCs in the agro sector, the future story, how you're looking at it.
Yeah, in India, agro sector, there are very few NBFCs who are dealing into the agro sector. Since we are into that in last 8 years, just understand that there is a change happened after COVID in agriculture, in distribution as well as the value chain management. Earlier, states were not accepting APMC Act abolition. Today, during this COVID, automatically everything is against the APMC Act. Everybody has accepted abolition of APMC Act. Everybody has started selling, farmers have started selling the produce directly to the end user, or you can say from farm to the fork. So it is to the consumption level, means they are coming directly to the societies and selling this thing. This is expected, and this was expected for a long time. Some of the states were not accepting abolition of APMC Act. Those states were accepted APMC Act. This, what you can say, value chain management of fruits and vegetables was happening very well. Now, what will happen to APMCs once we get out of this lockdown? Either they have to change, they have to start digital mechanism or electronic. I will not say digital, I will say electronic, because they were not having electronic payment. This thing where people have lost trust inside the artyas or other parameters within the APMCs. Please don't quote me wrong, but yes, that is there in the system. Even though government has started so many INAM and this thing, but what has happened into agriculture? It has took 5 years to convert one trade of INAM. After 5 years, it has happened day before yesterday on in some part of the country. So yes, agriculture, because of this COVID, they have started change, and they have to accept the change, or they will be thrown out by the change. So this is one of the things happen into the agriculture market. Yes, NBFC will change their product accordingly, and will try to service the needs of the borrower. And those needs of the borrowers only can be serviced only by NBFCs. Some of the locations, banks are not ready to entertain this, where NBFCs are entertaining. So I don't think there is much happen into agriculture because of that, because labor challenge was not there. There are hardly 25% external labor into the agriculture. All 75% of the own labor agri-industry was happening. So on labor part, it was not affected, but on sell part or proceed part, it was really affected. So I think from third, already rural economies partially it is on the line, and from third May it will start. At least 60-70% of the rural economy will start. That will take care of that. And it will take 5 to 6 months or 2 quarters to come back again.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Bobdeep, for shedding some light on the agro sector and the role of NBFCs. There are certain challenges. I think those can be overcome in the coming months and coming years or so. Mr. Pillai, Sachin Pillai, your concluding remark on the role or the future of NBFCs vis-a-vis the overall economic condition of the country. Where do you see the NBFC sector going?
You see, the importance of NBFC sector in the overall credit delivery happening in this country, you know, you just need to look at the data point. You know, more than 50% of the credit happening through the organized channel comes to the, you know, is through the NBFC route. And obviously, you know, as NBFCs, here I'm looking at NBFCs, HFCs, MFIs, all put together. You know, we serve the bottom of the pyramid, and therefore there is no other alternate mechanism which is there right now for, you know, in any form to serve that segment. It is only the NBFC segment which has been doing historically and would continue to do. So there's no questions asked in terms of the relevance of NBFCs, you know, and the continuation in terms of, you know, their effectiveness in, you know, delivering credit to that segment of the country or the society. Having said that, you know, every crisis, you know, comes up with opportunities as well. And, you know, we as NBFCs have been nimble-footed in the past in terms of reorienting ourselves to the, you know, the change scenario. We need not go long back in 2008-09 post the, you know, credit crisis, which happened. And, you know, before that, you had almost all the NBFCs and banks, you know, lending unsecured consumer durables, etc. And after the crisis, it stopped, and we saw the emergence of Bajaj coming into the same segment. They redefined the business out there, and we have seen the success that has come in out. You know, that's one example which, you know, is very recent for us. I'm sure, you know, post-COVID, the way the scenarios evolved, NBFCs will be one of the quickest and nimble-footed to reorient themselves and, you know, get it through, and, you know, look at how the business model change comes in from the change which is required at the from the customers end. And therefore, having that understanding, I guess NBFCs are the most best place to do that. So definitely, you know, re-emergence of new business models are very much out there, and NBFCs would be the first to embrace that and, you know, take it forward. And on the on the point that, you know, digital, you know, the digitization happening, obviously, you know, we as NBFCs, given the customer segment that we focus, we are more on touch rather than on tech. It's less of tech and more of touch that we, you know, the model that we follow. But obviously, we all are seeing over the recent past the emergence of tech and tech, you know, gaining ground over touch. And I guess this period in what we are going through right now, we ourselves in our company, we have seen how, you know, the digital acceptance in the customer, you know, has gone up during this period, during the last few weeks. And it is, the data is very heartening, you know, when we see, given the overall customer segment focus that we have. So I'm sure that, you know, this will give an impetus of tech, you know, moving across or, you know, gaining space as compared to what it was earlier, and, you know, replacing touch over a period. So that, you know, this, I would say this period has kind of given a window for that to happen. And I'm sure, you know, all the NBFC will see that happening. And therefore, you know, this is a reflection of the customer preference change which is happening, even in the segment which we believe otherwise, you know, are reluctant to move on to on tech. But we are seeing that change happening right now.
So taking cue from what Mr. Sachin has said, that change is happening, and we can feel and see the winds of change is slowly visible for this sector. I can see a plethora of questions, and I can see some questions also asked in the chat section, and where some of our panelists have already answered them, are also typing the answers to some of the questions raised in the chat section. If we come to Q&A section, I think there are a lot of questions. I think we can choose one question each, and all of you can reply to on that. And I can start with one question is by Mr. Sandeep. His question is, what could be the impact on affordable housing segments, especially self-employed, who are severely affected and may see a churn in NPA? Whether housing for all has gone into a halt since the PMAY's subsidy also expired? Are we really going to see any price cut in this segment where the margin is not so great? The question by Mr. Sandeep, once it is answered, then all of you can choose one question each and we can answer them. So maybe Mr. Sandeep's question can be answered by Mr. Raman Agarwal.
I think Can I request TTS sir to take that? It's most concerned the housing, affordable housing part. So I think he will be in a better position.
Well, I don't know about if I'm in a better position, but I'll take a stab at it. See, this goes back to my earlier point. Affordable housing is finally something that is going to be impacted by what's happening in the larger economy. So if there is going to be, if there are going to be a lot of job losses, if there are going to be brutal cuts in salaries, things like that, obviously it's going to affect house buying sentiment. That's on the one side. From a lending perspective, I think lenders too are going to probably get more risk averse, because if cash flows of people are going to come under strain, and especially in the affordable housing segment, I think they're a little more vulnerable. So my sense is that this segment will, in the near term, at least take a bit of a beating. But like everything else, I think over time, it should come back, because it is something very basic from the point of view of our economy, given the distribution of our population. So for the long term, it is still a great story. But in the near term, near to medium term, I think they will come under a fair bit of strain.
Thank you so much, Mr. TTS. And I'll just add on to that. Recent Union Minister, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, has also announced to housing sector that they should try to sell the houses in no profit, no loss format, so that the houses are being sold and people can still buy, with builders are not keeping much of margin in that. So maybe that can be a boost for the housing sector in future. There is a question by Mr. Trilochan Singh Basra. I think I can put this question to Mr. George Muthoot. Mr. Basra's question, Mr. Muthoot, is that as the pandemic is expected to last much longer, and maybe up to complete current financial year, how does 3-month monitoring support end users to cover the situation? And what are the expectations of NBFCs from government in form of bailout packages to support the NBFC sector to overcome the expected crisis? I may add to what Mr. Basra has asked to our panelists that there are a lot of questions on moratorium also. So maybe Mr.
Muthoot, I'll take that. Moratorium, I'll tell you.
Yeah.
Mr. George can first.
Yeah, so we can come to Mr. George and then Mr. Agarwal can answer on the moratorium part.
Okay. I think what the question would be, what will be the fate of the borrower? For that, they are getting moratorium. 3 months may be sufficient, but if the moratorium or the customer is, as I said earlier, is allowed, or the NBFC is allowed to show it in his books, not as a non-NPA, even after 90 days or 120 days, 150 days, 180 days, etc., everybody's problem will be solved. That is what my take on this is. Because in 3 months, so nobody is going to get back to normal. So it will take more time for them. So you may have to give more time. So moratorium may have to be given, not moratorium though, but giving you more time to repay. So and along with that, if you also do a one-time restructuring of the loan. Today, one-time restructuring of loan is not permitted. If that permission is also given, it will be win-win for both the borrower as well as for the NBFC.
Alex, can I just supplement what you said? On the restructuring, actually, there is a clarification. There is a circular from RBI which says you can do a one-time rescheduling of all MSME accounts.
MSME,
yeah.
Till right? March 11.
That is possible. That is possible now up to December 2020. However, there is a stipulation that you must make a 5% provision, additional provision, if you do this restructuring. So yeah. Part of the representation that has gone from FIDC to the regulator, there's two things we've asked for. A, we've said, please permit rescheduling for everyone, not just MSMEs, but for everyone. And B, please do not insist on this additional provisioning. So this is a request that's already been made. It's gone to the regulator, and we're following up on that. We're hoping that this will be heard favorably. Because as all of my colleagues have pointed out on the panel, the restructuring, a one-time restructuring, is an absolute prerequisite if our small borrowers especially have to tide through this situation. Otherwise, you're going to find a very, very large number of people with horrible credit scores.
That's good. Thank you.
Right.
If I can, Shavik, if I can add in on to Mr. TTS's point, Sachin,
yeah? Yeah, Mr. Sachin, please.
Yeah, as Mr. TTS rightly pointed out, you know, while that window for restructuring is there, but that 5% provision, you know, to be taken is something, it's more, as much as I understand, corrected if not, is for banks and for NBFCs, you know, it has been referred to the ICAI, so a bit technical, because NBFCs have migrated into Ind AS accounting standards, whereas, you know, banks are still on the Indian GAAP side. So we still don't have clarity in terms of what provisions NBFCs need to take in case, you know, we have to use that one window for restructuring for MSMEs, and therefore we are holding back, because, you know, we all have moved into ECL provisioning, and given the individual asset class ECL, whether it makes sense for us to look at half of that to be taken upfront doesn't, you know, kind of. So we are still waiting for clarity coming on that side from the ICAI and then taking it to our individual boards that suggested by RBI. So actually, for NBFCs, that restructuring window, you know, is not. I mean, we don't have a approach or a framework for us to go and, you know, do it for. And as Mr. TTS very rightly pointed out, we should get it for all asset classes minus of this provision required.
Right. Mr. Raman Agarwal, want to add something on the moratorium part?
Yeah, see, I think I do see a lot of questions on the moratorium. Now, let's understand it this way. The original RBI circular dated 27th March was, I think, quite clear. Let's appreciate two facts. One, see, the circular never said that you have to give moratorium. The circular said the banks, NBFCs, lending institutions, as they call, are permitted to give moratorium. So what that does mean, that meant it left to the discretion of each lending institution to give moratorium or not, number one. Number two, it never made any distinction that, you know, whether NBFCs are covered or not covered. It simply said all lending institutions are permitted to give moratorium to all borrowers, including corporates. So there was no ambiguity. The real ambiguity actually started when there was a FAQ put out by the Indian Banks Association. And there was a reference drawn, and somewhere it was stated that perhaps this may not be applicable to NBFCs. And after that, there was a lot of confusion in the market. We also saw Indian Banks Association meeting, and after a long meeting, said that we need to see clarification from RBI. Subsequently, RBI governor made a public statement saying that RBI never has made any distinction. They have no problems. So as things stand today is what we stand on 27th March, that technically there is no stopping banks to give moratorium to NBFCs. However, what we need to appreciate is that it is left to the discretion of each bank. So each bank board have taken a call whether to give it or not. We know that while many of the banks have not given moratorium, but on the same side, we have come across some banks who have given moratorium. So it's purely left to the discretion of the banks. Let's be clear. Now, yes, that's a different matter. We as a industry body had said that, you know, and as I think initially TTS sir also said, George also mentioned, that, you know, in the absence of us getting a moratorium, we are unnecessarily creating mismatch in the system, which needs to be addressed. But technically, there is no stopping banks, but practically on ground, banks have taken a call, some of them, not to give it moratorium. So that's where. But as things stand today, see, the moratorium was till what? 3 months, March, April, and May. Already 2 months have passed. Now, I think as we see today, the more important issue, as has been discussed already, is restructuring rather than moratorium. So I think if we are given this leeway of one-time restructuring, that would be a far better relief. Having said that, there is already a hue and cry being made that whether, you know, the moratorium needs to be extended, because perhaps it is felt
that's my next question, because it was primarily given.
Yeah, so because with the lockdown getting extended,
yes,
there is a lot of demand. Now, that's a call which the RBI needs to take. And yes, if there is a decision made that yes, there is going to be some kind of a further moratorium, then certainly NBFCs have a strong case that we should be given. And I think now there is no doubt left. Banks can't say that RBI needs to clarify or there is no doubt left. I mean, everybody has said it. There is nobody stopping. So banks need to take a call. If the moratorium is extended, I think it should be given to NBFCs.
Yes, I think this part is very important because a lot of questions I can see. And also, this discourse is happening on public space every day about the moratorium and whether the moratorium will be extended. But then how banks are going to give that relief to NBFC, that's an important part. I think government and all have to sit together and to find ways, because this 3-month moratorium was initially announced in the beginning of March. But now the lockdown is being extended. So the same problem persists.
See, this has so to be to be clearly taken by the bank's call. And I think, you know, let's appreciate, regulator cannot put a blanket and say, no, you have to give it. See, they left it to the discretion of the banks. And as they left it to the discretion to NBFCs also. But as all my panelists have already said, you know, majority of the NBFCs and all of them have already offered moratorium to our customers.
Right.
So I think banks need to be more judicious in that. And I think I am
not only.
Yeah.
And not I only sure. Our most of the borrowers, they have requested also for a moratorium.
Yeah. And Shovik, I think there is another element to this. We are only now talking about banks. But if you look at the funding profile of NBFCs, we have borrowings not only from banks, we have borrowings from mutual funds, from insurance companies who invest in our NCDs, and then there's securitized paper, and then there's direct assignments which we do. So there's a whole range of liability instruments, right, that NBFCs have. Right. So to confine it only to say banks should offer a moratorium doesn't address the issue. So on the one hand, NBFCs are in a position where, though Raman says technically the language used is permission to give, in reality, given the class of our borrowers, it is for all intents and purposes an 80-85% moratorium that we have granted. So back to back, it has to be matched. Otherwise, you run into a serious problem in terms of ALM. I think this is the point that we've been trying to make from day one, and which is why I think the point that both Alex and Sachin made earlier about restructuring, and I think Prabhakar made the point as well. I think a one-time restructuring where individual entities, individual NBFCs can sit down with their customers, work out what will be the comfort in terms of their cash flows, reschedule them so that it's not a blanket moratorium, but a slow stepped-up repayment, because as they get back on track, as their businesses start to come back online, slowly they will be able to step up, right? That way you don't turn off the tap completely, but you also make sure that the cash flows start coming in. So it's more complex than just a stop start.
Right. So thanks for this enlightening insight on the moratorium part. I think we'll take the last question. This question is by Mr. Pratik Tibrewala. His question is that which of these areas do you want technology to help you most? Reaching out to more prospects faster, customer retention and loyalty, easing out loan process and compliance to RBI norms. Can I get an answer from Prabhakar Bobde and Mr. Sachin can add on to that? So there are four questions. Reaching out to more prospects faster, customer retention and loyalty, easing out loan process, compliance to RBI norms. Where do you see future technology leverage for the NBFC sector?
I think all of us are using technology for sourcing of cases as well as managing the portfolio as well as the compliance part also. Now, after Ind AS has come and it has become compulsory to all NBFCs, we have to do a lot of jugglery in managing the database and provisioning. So we require digital space in all this, in managing our organization. And this is the biggest challenge. I think maybe small NBFC may be facing challenges in this part because they are not capable of putting so much money into big softwares. But yes, we are putting money into the softwares, but we are facing challenges. They are not capable of handling our requirement. So yes, I think it's all four questions are there. The way, which part digital requirement is there? Yes, all four parts we require digital support. Yeah, Sachin, your take.
Yeah, Mr. Sachin, you can.
Yeah, you see, you know, we keep talking about digital, but end of the day, the success of, you know, any endeavor lies in, you know, in this case, you know, digital, which lies in how the customers embrace that, you know, processes and technology, and, you know, start transacting or responding to that. That's where, you know, I would say, otherwise, you know, NBFCs, there would, you know, everybody would love to go to, make it digitized, you know, save on their cost and, you know, have a better engagement with the customer. But as Mr. TTS has rightly pointed out, you know, the class of customers that we deal with, there is a personalized, you know, a touch feel which has to be there while we are, you know, looking at appraising their, loan requirement. So it's all about customers embracing technology and, you know, using it and, you know, willing to transact on it and engage with us on that. We are seeing, as I told you in this window within the last 5 weeks, we are seeing, increased pace of customers' acceptance levels going towards and, you know, looking at technology, which was not there in the past. So I'm sure that, you know, if the person who asks a question comes from an IT company or a digital kind of, you know, initiative leader, the way forward would be that what from their side they can do for educating these customers who are at the bottom of the pyramid in terms of the ease of operations and the kind of, you know, better experience that they can have, and that would play a role more for, you know, the digitized kind of, you know, thing to happen for this segment of customers. Otherwise, you know, as an NBFC, as a company, I would love that my entire processes are digitized and, you know, everything happens on through the thing. But that is not how the reality is. So therefore, you know, where the main impediment is going to come is the customers, you know, ability or the customer's willingness to embrace and, you know, take forward and look at the digital, you know, initiatives and, you know, transact through that and engage through that. That's where, you know, I feel the key is going to be.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Sachin Pillai, Mr. Raman Agarwal, Mr. TTS, Mr. George Muthoot, Mr. Prabhakar Botbe, for enlightening all of us and all our viewers, all our attendees on the role of NBFCs in COVID era and what is there in store in for future. And I'm sure that it was a learning experience for me, and I'm sure all our attendees and who are seeing this live broadcast in Facebook have gained a lot of insight on the overall NBFC sector working in COVID era. Before we conclude and say bye to all of us, can we have one line on Elitz Technomedia and the banking and finance post from all of you? To start with Mr. Raman Agarwal.
No, I think I have been associated, and you've been calling me for various events, and I've seen some very, very, you know, innovative efforts being made. You know, you guys often even, you know, appreciate and award some of the performing NBFCs. A lot of focus on technology, all the burning issues. And now with this webinar concept, I must congratulate, and I think a very good initiative in this era to provide clarity to people across. So I think my compliments to you. Keep up the good work.
Mr. TTS.
Shovik, thank you for, putting this together, because I think more than anything else, this is a time for collaboration, right? Because as I said right up front, this is a problem which is totally egalitarian in nature. It's hit all of us, and it's hit all of us with the same intensity. So I think any opportunity for all of us to come together, to collaborate, to share ideas, which will help us as an industry and as a country to move forward, overcome the huge challenge that this pandemic has thrown at us. I think all efforts in that direction are very welcome. And to that extent, I think the initiative that you guys have taken is truly laudable. So thank you. And I hope we were able to add some value to your panelists. I hope we were able to answer some of their questions. Hopefully we helped them understand a little bit about, you know, what this animal called NBFC is. And if we succeeded a little bit in that, I think this webinar would have been worth the while. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. TTS. Mr. George Alexander Muthoot, your take on Elite Technomedia and the Banking and Finance Post magazine.
Yeah, I too agree that this is the right time to do such a webinar. NBFCs, etc., and also the public are going through very tough times. And any such seminars which will bring us together, which will be probably seen or heard by the regulators and decision makers, is always welcome. I hope, I'm sure that you will try your best to take it to the regulators or to the decision makers or to the ministry, etc. Problems not only faced by NBFCs, the problems faced by NBFCs is because of the problems faced by its customers. So both should survive. The customer should survive, only then NBFCs will survive. Only after that, the economy also will survive. So I think you did a good thing. Such things are always welcome. And I hope, I also thank the other panelists and also hope that I was also able to add some value to the deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Muthoot. Mr. Bobdev, your take on us.
Yes, Souvik, I'm attending your seminars regularly for last 2 years, and it was really great. You guys are really always charged up in arranging such conferences. And now I think after COVID-18, you guys will prefer to not to come to Bombay, but prefer to come digitally only. So that I think all except Sachin and me, we are in Mumbai. All other people are not in Mumbai, right? So this is the change what has happened in due to COVID, and is always a welcome change which is reducing the cost. And all of us, we have to take care that economy is challenging. COVID has challenged economy, COVID has challenged banks, they have challenged NBFCs also. So there is nothing different. NBFCs are facing, they are also facing same challenge. So let me congratulate Elite for arranging such a nice webinars, and keep on doing it. Thank you, all my panelists also.
Thank you so much. Mrs. Sachin Pillai.
Thank you, Souvik, for having me around. Unlike the other panelists, this was the first time that I've been on this webinar organized by Elite Technomedia. And let me tell you, it's a step in time that, you know, it is very much required. As I was been emphasizing over the last 1 hour, you know, this is a period where, if not anything else, the level of engagements have to go up. And, you know, the understanding, therefore, you know, collectively needs to come in. And I think what you're doing is a tremendous job on that side. And I was very happy to be here. It was a good learning to hear, you know, industry veterans, you know, speaking about the issues that as a NBFC industry that we are facing. And there are a lot of takeaways that has come to me. And I'm sure for all the people who are there listening to us, and, you know, all panel members have been able to contribute and, you know, give them some, you know, kind of a light in terms of how the industry is faring and how do we see it going forward. Thank you so much for, you know, having me here.
Thank you so much, Mr. Raman Agarwal, Mr. T.T. Srinivas Raghavan, Mr. George Alexander Muthoot, Mr. Prabhakar Bobde, and Mr. Sachin Pillai for giving insights on the overall NBFC ecosystem in the country and what kind of situations being faced in the COVID era in India. And just to remind all of you and all of the viewers that entire webinar has been broadcasted live through Elite's handle, the Banking and Finance Post magazine handle, and other handles of Elite's in Facebook. Also, live tweeting has happened. Also, posts have happened in LinkedIn. And we are organizing a series of webinars, as I was saying in the beginning, in 30 plus sectors. We will continue to do that. You can log into elitesonline.com/webinar.com, and you can find all the details of our upcoming webinars and also the past webinars we have done in last 1 month. As I said in the very beginning, that we believe in the power of connecting people and communities, and our trust with connecting people and communities, even during the unprecedented times of COVID-19 and lockdown, will continue with our webinar initiatives. So be connected with us, but stay home, stay safe, and join our next webinar today at 5:30 p.m. And we must say before we end that we shall overcome this together. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Stay home. Stay at home.